JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for January the 20th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar continued to trade lower against all but one of the other G10 currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian session Wednesday. It lost the most ground versus SEK, NOK, the euro and the pound in that order, while it was found virtually unchanged against the New Zealand dollar. The weakening of the US dollar suggests that the markets continued trading in a risk-on fashion yesterday. However, the fact that the safe havens franc and yen strengthened somewhat raises questions on that front. Thus, in order to get a clearer picture with regards to the broader investor morale, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, major EU indices slid somewhat, but Wall Street's main indices traded in the green, with Nasdaq gaining the most, 1.53%. After being closed on Monday for the Martin Luther King Day, perhaps this was a catch-up with markets elsewhere. It could also be a reaction to comments by US Treasury Secretary nominee Janet Yellen. At her confirmation hearing, Yellen said that the benefits of a big spending package outweighed the cost of a higher debt burden. The upbeat appetite rolled over into the Asian session as well. Although Japan's Nikkei 225 slid 0.38%, China's Shanghai Composite, Hong Kong's Hang Seng, and South Korea's KOSPI gained 0.47%, 0.90%, and 0.71% respectively. Now, as for today, market participants may lock their gaze on Joe Biden's inauguration as the 46th US president. Usually such events pass unnoticed by the markets, as who will be the next president is already known well before. However, this time there is the risk of for Trump's supporters to proceed with more violent protests, as they still refuse to accept that the outcome of the elections was fair and clear. In such a case, a risk of wave may be possible, resulting in corrective moves in most markets. However, we stick to our guns that the path of least resistance for risk-linked assets remains to the upside. We repeat that the vaccinations, the US spending package, the monetary policy support around the globe, and the softer stance on global trade by Biden are a cocktail of developments that may keep the broader appetite supported in the first months of 2021. Now, apart from Biden's inauguration, we also have a Bank of Canada meeting on today's agenda. After scaling back its QE purchases in October, the Bank of Canada decided to keep its policy unchanged in December, noting that the rebound in the global and Canadian economies has unfolded largely as the bank anticipated in its October monetary policy report. Officials acknowledged that the positive vaccine news is providing some reassurance, but added that the pace and breadth of the global rollout of vaccinations remains uncertain. Overall, the language was on the neutral side. However, with inflation still well below the bank's objective of 2% and the latest employment report revealing that the Canadian economy has lost 62,600 jobs, we see a decent likelihood for the bank to re-increase its QE purchases at this gathering, something that could hurt the Canadian dollar. That said, we don't expect this to last for long. We still believe that the overall path of this commodity currency will depend on developments surrounding the broader sentiment. As we already noted, we see risk appetite improving in 2021, at least in the first months, something that could prove supportive for oil prices and thereby for the Canadian dollar. For the loonie to tumble and stay under selling interest for a while, Bank of Canada policymakers may have to surprise the markets with a rate cut. Nonetheless, we believe that the chances for something like that are minimal, as officials themselves have said that 0.25% is the lower effective bound. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the early European morning, we already got the UK CPIs for December. Both the headline and core rates rose more than anticipated, but stayed notably below the Bank of England's objective of 2%, which suggests that the prospect of the bank increasing the pace of its QE purchases at some point soon is not off the table. In any case, this is something the bank already knows that it stands ready to do, thus it will not come as a major surprise if it happens. Later in the day, we have Eurozone's final CPIs for December and Canadian inflation prints for the same month. Eurozone's figures are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates. While in Canada, the headline CPI rate is forecast to have held steady at 1%, while no forecast is available for the core rate. In any case, we don't expect loonie traders to pay much attention to the inflation data, as their gaze may be locked on the Bank of Canada decision due out later in the day. As for tonight, during the Asian session Thursday, the central bank torch will be passed to the Bank of Japan. When it last met, the bank announced no changes to its major monetary policy settings, but extended its funding support program to firms that was introduced earlier this year in response to the coronavirus pandemic. The only factor we see as tempting Japanese officials to hit the easing button is the weakening of the US dollar against the Japanese yen. However, the recent rebound in dollar yen may have provided some comfort. With the Bank of Japan's policy already being extremely loose, we believe that policymakers may wait for things to worsen much more before they decide to ease further. Australia's employment report for December is also due to be released. The unemployment rate is expected to have ticked down to 6.7% from 6.8%, while the net change in employment is forecast to show that the economy has gained 50,000 jobs after adding 90,000 in November. At its December meeting, the RBA stood pat, repeating that they are prepared to do more if necessary. That said, with the bank noting that the Australian economic recovery is underway and that recent data have generally been better than expected, we don't believe that the slowdown in jobs growth will be the trigger for more easing. After all, a slowdown following the 178,800 and 90,000 job gains in October and November appears more than normal to us. Japan's trade balance for December is also coming out, and expectations are for the nation's surplus to have increased to 942.8 billion yen from 366.1 billion. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the Weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.